CPIL, and we have Mihira Sood and Sahana Manjesh as speakers today. Mihira is the Executive Director of the Center for Child Rights and Juvenile Justice and a visiting professor of law at the National Law University, Delhi. She has been a practicing advocate at the courts since 2007, where she has acted in a variety of matters, including on sexual violence, child abuse, family law, domestic violence, writ petitions, media law, consumer complaints, commercial disputes, criminal law, public interest, and public interest litigation. She qualified as an advocate on record of the Supreme Court in 2014. Sahana is an advocate practicing in the child and appellate courts in Mumbai. Her practice includes representing children in conflict with the law. She has previously been a litigation associate with Project 39A, which is a legal research, pro bono litigation, and public engagement center based out of National Law University, Delhi. Thank you so much for the support extended by Article 14 for this excellent and much needed conversation. And thank you, Mihira and Sahana, for your time. We will be taking questions towards the end of the discussion and a few housekeeping rules. Please keep yourself on mute if you are not being spoken to. And the question and answer round will be towards the end. If you have any questions that you feel are pertinent, please do write them in the chat box and we'll take them towards the end. So beginning with the topic itself, which states hard cases and bad law, child of children as adults for heinous offences. So before we begin and we dive into this topic, what are the heinous offences? What are we looking here, Mihira? If you don't mind taking it forward.
Yeah, so this is an amendment that was passed after, you know, what is called the Nirbhaya incident in response to the fact that one of the accused in that case was a juvenile, and there was a lot of public outrage about the fact that he was getting, what was perceived to be far too lenient a sentence. And the provision in Section 15 of the Juvenile Justice Act now says that if a person is completed 16 years, but is less than 18 years and is accused of committing a heinous offence, which is defined as anything where the minimum punishment, not the maximum, but the minimum punishment is 7 years or more, that person may be tried as an adult. It is not mandatory. There are certain safeguards in place, at least on paper, and I think Sahana is best place to talk about how those safeguards don't necessarily translate into reality. But at least on paper, the Juvenile Justice Board has to make an assessment as to whether or not that person, that child, had the mental and physical capacity to commit that act and appreciate the consequences of that act. That assessment may also include a psychosocial component, also looking into the circumstances and the context in which the act was committed. So at least on paper, there is supposed to be some a difference in the way an adult is tried, even because the focus here is a lot more on the circumstances surrounding the act and not that much on the severity and the, you know, past conduct and other things that get taken into account when an adult is tried. As far as the trial is concerned, there are requirements that there has to be a child-friendly court environment and things like that. And an ICP, an individual care plan, has to be drawn up. So rehabilitation is theoretically really the focus, even when it comes to children being tried as adults, which is different from some other jurisdictions that do allow children to be tried as adults, the United States, for example, where there isn't as much of a focus on rehabilitation. There's also a provision where a child who has been tried as an adult may be taken, convicted, may be taken to a place of safety so that they do not, come into the harsh environment of a jail. So India, surprisingly, is not alone in having this kind of a provision. There are other countries, though not a lot. One of the major conditions, at least as far as international human rights law is concerned and international child rights law is concerned, the main restriction that India does comply with is that a child cannot, in under any circumstances, be given the death penalty or be awarded life imprisonment without the possibility of release. So to that extent, yes, India does comply with that. But having said that, as I said, Sahana is best placed to talk about what all this really means in reality in terms of what is the kind of legal representation that children get when they are tried, and what is the application of mind of the Juvenile Justice Board when they are committing children to be tried as adults by what is called children's court. And, the need to not give in to public pressure when it's the question of a case that just, you know, for whatever reason or variety of reasons, just happens to have caught public attention. And there's a lot of public pressure. So the need to avoid that. That's basically the legal framework and the background in which this was brought in. This does, however, ignore the fact that one of the main reasons we have a Juvenile Justice Act and we have juvenile justice protection is because there is a recognition that, you know, neuroscience recognizes that the brain does not develop sufficiently to appreciate things like risk, consequence. You know, that part of the brain is not fully developed at the age of 16. And that's one of the main reasons why the juvenile justice law was framed the way it was. So to have suddenly come up with this formulation, there is an internal contradiction because it doesn't really gel with what your logic has been for the juvenile justice scheme thus far. And it does not gel with international, contemporary medical science on this front. And the idea that, because this is a heinous offense, this will have a deterrent effect. There really isn't any evidence to suggest that the more severe the punishment, the higher the deterrence. So there is really, while the only thing that has changed here or the only thing that appears to have weighed with policymakers here was the gravity of the offense. But that doesn't really change anything in relation to the offender and the need to have certain protections in place with regard to certain categories of offenders. So that logic doesn't really hold.
Sahana, do you mind addressing something here? Or should I?
Yeah. So, thanks, Mihira, for setting out the context so very well. And this is really an important sort of background to understand the nitty-gritties of how it ends up playing in the court or before the JJ board. So Section 15, which is basically the process of preliminary assessment, as they call it, where a juvenile who is above 16 years of age, but of course below 18 years of age, is sort of assessed, so to speak, to determine if that child was behaving in a childlike manner or was the child behaving in an adult manner. And that's a very, very vague understanding. There really is no way we can understand what it means to be a child and what it means to be an adult. But because the law requires this process of assessment to happen, JJ boards are required to take three things into consideration in terms of the processes themselves. One is to get a mental health report, which is something that a psychiatrist gives to be distinguished from what a psychologist may come out with as an assessment. So there's a mental health report. There is a physical health report, which is really like an assessment by a physician to see if the child has any issues or concerns physically, has any problems, and that sort of thing. And the third report, which is primarily before the Juvenile Justice Board, and this is there for all children in conflict with the law, is a report of the probation officer. So there's a particular format that the JJ Act sort of prescribes, where you're supposed to look at the background of the child, the family, the economic status they come from, the social status, what is the person's progress in school. It's a very elaborate sort of report which is supposed to be filled in. So these are the three documents that are before the Juvenile Justice Board, are required to be before the Juvenile Justice Board. And problematically, I feel, what the section also does is to make it not mandatory, but one of the options available before the Juvenile Justice Board is to also seek a psychologist's sort of understanding and assessment of the child. That is rarely done in practice, you know, because of the fact that it is not a mandatory step in this entire assessment. That is something that's never really done. Although, again, the Act says that there's supposed to be a board, which is to be made up of mental health professionals who are capable of making such an assessment of the child. And why this becomes important is because of the manner in which a mental health report ends up coming, right? It's often just like three or four sentences. Almost every juvenile's mental health report reads the same, because all that it's going to say is that this is a child who, unless of course the child has a mental health concern, it is normally going to say that there is no abnormality, that there is no psychosis, there is no mental health concern, so to speak, that the child has. So what the mental health report does is to therefore help the Juvenile Justice Board assess whether or not this has to be a trial that has to await, because maybe the child is actually not in a position to continue to face the trial because of this mental incapacity, an incapacity that is applicable even to adults under the IPC, CRPC and that framework. So that's really the limited purpose of the mental health report. It cannot and does not tell us what was the mindset of the child at the particular time of the alleged incident. It does not tell us what are the concerns that the child has to face and what are the problems that the child is placed within, which may have compelled him or her to take the action that he or she may have done. So it becomes a very perfunctory exercise. And what this mental health report is often read to mean that the child was capable of committing the offense simply because there is no abnormality. And that's a very ridiculous reading of a mental health report. So that's one problem, which is supposed to be sort of buttressed with the psychologist's evaluation, which could be a more holistic understanding. But that's rarely ever done. It's rarely ever pushed for by lawyers. And even if it is, what we're often faced with from the other side is that, you know, we don't have these kind of persons who can make the assessment that you're asking us to do. The second thing is, of course, the physical health report. Again, this can only tell us if there is something that is extremely difficult in terms of saying that the child may not have physically been capable of committing the crime. But the fact that the child is physically firm does not, again, mean that he or she is to be treated as an adult. But again, this report is read against the child as opposed to being a neutral assessment of what the physical condition was. The next requirement is to look at the circumstances of the case and whether the child could understand the consequences of the action that he or she is alleged to have committed. And this is where things become even more subjective, right? With the mental health assessment and physical health assessment, there's at least like a small checklist to be ticked off. But with the circumstances and understanding the circumstances, what should ideally be driven by a psychologist's assessment or even a probation officer's report, because they're very extensive, is rarely the case. What the JJ board ends up doing in a lot of cases, and because of course of the nature of the crime, which is heinous, so these are primarily cases of sexual assault or murder, the very fact that the case or the crime is allegedly so big is in and of itself the reason for them to treat this to be a circumstance wherein the child has to be treated as an adult. Now, why would there have been in our legislative process an entire assessment requirement with all of these different steps and these reports required if we were to make this such a, you know, sort of step that can be overlooked? Which is in effect what we see in a lot of cases. And of course, it started out with say high profile cases, and obviously Nirbhaya and the amendments that happened following that case sort of made the JJBs look at grievous offenses very differently, heinous offenses very differently. Now you see it doesn't even really require a case of that kind of magnitude. It doesn't even require public outrage or outcry or any of that. As the moment the JJ board is faced with a child who is alleged to have committed murder, say, irrespective of whether the child has perhaps, and I'm not saying that these should be the yardsticks, but perhaps what could be considered and what judgments have considered in the past is to look at whether there was premeditation of the crime. Did the child plan it beforehand? Was there a lot of calculation in terms of hiding the evidence? All of these things are circumstances that may be considered to determine the state of mind of that child. But in the absence of having any of these safeguards, and in the absence of a JJ board actually realizing that the importance of this process of the preliminary assessment, what happens is that even when a child is, you know, saying that they had no idea that this accident could lead to a crime, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what justification they give. And the important thing to really realize and understand at this stage is that although the child may be 16 plus, they're highly impressionable. There is a reason in the law that confession statements made before a police officer is inadmissible as evidence, even for adults. Now, take that and place that same framework for a child, and you will see in the mental health report or the physical health assessment or even the probation officer report, the child is often almost always volunteering a lot of information, which should not be read as evidence, is sort of excluded. But the suggestibility of a juvenile is so high that they volunteer a lot of information. And although we know it shouldn't be read in evidence because it's in writing, all of these circumstances somehow almost always sort of guide how the Juvenile Justice Board determines this preliminary assessment. And the other important, and these are again procedural issues that end up becoming a really big hurdle for a child to cross, is the fact that the documents, right, all of these documents are supposed to be given to the child beforehand. The witness statements are supposed to be given to the child beforehand. So although Section 15 specifically says that this assessment process should not be in the nature of a trial, there is still a requirement for all of these documents to be given to the juvenile so that he or she has a fighting chance to make their case. But these documents are rarely given, you know, because of the fact that, again, there's a time-bound manner in which the process has to proceed. It ends up being a situation where the child does not have these documents. And very often we find that these are children who go unrepresented before the Juvenile Justice Board. They're supposed to have their parents along with them. Often parents are not a part of the process. Legal aid is of course, I mean, it's a problem with the adult system also, but to imagine a separate legal aid system for the Juvenile Justice Board is that much more difficult. And that's what we see in practice. So for instance, there was a study that was conducted a few years ago by the Center for Children and Law at the National Law School in Bangalore. And that was specific, and it was very specific to Bangalore's JJBs and its functioning. And what the report shows, and I presume this would be the case everywhere, is that a majority of children go either poorly represented or even unrepresented before the Juvenile Justice Board. So all of these steps and these processes and these circumstances that perhaps could have been argued differently, put before the JJB differently, don't end up happening. So this child is then automatically, almost automatically, I would say, transferred before the children's court. And children's court is really a misnomer, I would say, because ultimately it is a special court, right? It's a special court like under any special statute, which is an existing sessions court, which is given an additional charge of hearing cases that come under these special laws. So it may be called the children's court. The law may require it to be child-friendly, but it is not child-friendly in any manner, because a child is brought in just like any adult would be brought in. Sometimes the judges don't even know that this is a CCL. They have to be reminded about this. I would say that the procedural safeguards, though they exist on paper, really don't reflect in how it ends up translating into reality.
Thank you so much, Sahana and Mihira, for firstly setting out what heinous offences are, what the background and context of the act which was introduced, and what the procedural and the fallacies of that procedure are. But I have like a follow-up question to that would be then, since there is a lot of discretionary issues, firstly. Secondly, since they're also going to the children's court, like you explained, which are just normal courts, and they have to, like, they're just tried on as adults. So what do you think are some of the implications of being tried as an adult, and what does it mean for the child per se? Either of you can go ahead, Sahana, if you're comfortable, sure, go ahead.
I'll start. Maybe Mihira can add after this. See, the implication really is very, very huge. And that's really the tragedy of this. Because if you are being tried as a juvenile, then the maximum punishment, if you could call it punishment, is 3 years, where you can be placed in an observation home or a children's home for a maximum period of 3 years, along with a host of other rehabilitative processes that are a part of this, what they believe to be the commensurate response to the alleged crime. And there's a whole gradation of what could be imposed by the juvenile justice board. You know, sending the child into custody to a children's home is just one of them. It could also be something as simple as admonition. It could be something like a community service direction. There are multiple different combinations of responses that the juvenile justice board can impose. And also the composition of the juvenile justice board itself is very different from a court, right? So you have a magistrate and you also have two non-legal people sitting who are basically people who come from a social welfare background. So the entire process itself is non-adversarial. So the implication, of course, and the process, both of these things, I think, make a huge difference, because once you're being tried as an adult before a children's court, of course, you may not be given a sentence of death or a sentence of life without remission. But I mean, there is still a possibility of being sent in for life. And the difference between 3 and life is huge. And also in terms of, see, until the age of 21, until they reach 21, if they're found guilty of the offense, they will continue to be in these children's homes. But once they hit 21, again, there's supposed to be a process of determining whether there has been some kind of reform and whether keeping that child, now an adult, in custody serves any purpose. But again, that's a conversation for another day when that too doesn't happen. So what ends up happening is that they're rotated from the children's home into an adult system, into a prison, where it is impossible to implement the reformation and rehabilitation measures that were supposed to have been part of this entire sentencing process.
Thank you so much, Sahana. Mihira, what do you think it means for the child as well? I mean, going forward, if you could address that.
I mean, I think another really important issue here is the question, and of course, it has implications for adults as well, but, you know, we need to appreciate that these implications are just so much more magnified when it comes to children. And, you know, you're talking about a record, you're talking about the person's name and identifying information, and things like that, and those kind of safeguards, you know, not necessarily being, you know, being observed when it comes to children being tried as adults and those kind of things. Then, I mean, you know, we talk about rehabilitation, and this is something, you know, Sahana and I were talking about when we had a chat last week. We talk about rehabilitation, we talk about, but how is it even assessed? It's really assessed in the barest of terms. Do they return to, you know, do they commit crimes again? What is the rate of recidivism? But there's really no assessment as to the quality of life that people are living, you know, having spent time in the juvenile justice system, their education, their employment opportunities, their integration into society. You know, there's really no assessment of, are they thriving, which surely is the goal of rehabilitation. You know, you're really assessing it, and in not just, I mean, in India, that kind of data doesn't really exist anyway. But even even abroad, when you look for that kind of data, it's just done on the bare minimum basis of do they get back in the system or do they stay clean, so to speak? That's all it is. So I think in that sense, of course, the implications for a child are huge in terms of the quality of life, the level of integration and acceptance, employment, employability, things like that.
Thank you so much, Mihira. So obviously, all of the issues that do reside in the normal criminal justice system all are magnified, as Mihira said, you know, especially when it comes to a child. So something that Mihira had touched on in her introductory remarks was neuroscience. And she said that neuroscience does not actually, does not allow for this sort of system to operate. Either or can go first, but yeah, what does the latest neuroscience say about it? Why is it necessary for children to be having a different system versus the adults? You're on mute, Mihira.
I was saying I already spoke about this a bit, so do you want to go ahead and say something on that, Sahana?
Not really, just to say, I mean, I think neuroscience is something that's very difficult for us as lawyers to comprehend and understand, and it's constantly evolving. And I just thought I could draw a parallel between, you know, neuroscience and how we look at it with the juvenile system, and neuroscience and how, say, we try to use it in cases of death penalty. You know, even in death penalty cases, one of the factors that is considered to be a mitigating factor is a young age of an offender. So when, say, a person is about 19, 20, 21 at the alleged date of the incident, and the sentence imposed is of death, I mean, courts have routinely sort of commuted their sentences saying that they were too young. But actually, the basis of that is to say that, you know, the mind is really not very well formed for a very long period of time. Some say that it goes on into, say, well within your early 20s. It's not even that 18 is that particular age where, you know, you're fully formed and you know how to make decisions. And you may also be able to make decisions. You just don't really understand the consequences of it. And that's really why I suppose the whole world is reflecting on it in the manner that it is, right? Because ultimately, the law has to peg a number. It has to peg an age. So whether it's 16 or 17 or 18 or 19, I think it's almost always going to be arbitrary. But yes, I mean, I suppose the understanding that 16 is still different from 18 or 14 is still different from 16 is the fact that there is a process of development that's still happening with a young adult. And there really seems to be no scope for understanding that within at least the preliminary assessment process.
Okay. Thank you.
I just wanted to add to that. I wanted to look up which exactly is that part of the brain, because, you know, as lawyers, it's called the prefrontal cortex, right? And that part of the brain doesn't really develop, as Sahana said, till you're, you know, in your early 20s. And what it really regulates are the things that, you know, adolescents are really known for, you know, impulsiveness, reckless behavior, risky behavior, things that can, you know, in the wrong circumstances, you know, result in, you know, unfortunate crime being committed. And that's, it's exactly that kind of behavior. I mean, you know, that when you're an adolescent, your brain is developing and, you know, hormonal development and all the rest of it. But there is a reason why we don't really allow a lot of, you know, heavily consequential activities to children below the age of 18, 21 in some cases, 25 in other cases. And I mean, if the law is willing to recognize, rightly or wrongly, but the law does recognize that, you know, one, you know, does not, cannot, you know, safely consume alcohol till the age of 21 or 25, you know, depending on what part of the country you live in, then, you know, we have, even for adults, you recognize provocation, right? You recognize a loss of control. You recognize some, your temper getting the better of you. Now, imagine how that is for a teenager, you know, just the complete lack of perspective in terms of how important an event is in their lives. I mean, we've all been there. Things just seem so, you know, massively, outsizedly important that they need to be responded to or reacted to instantly. That's a very natural thing for a teenager. And it's that part of the brain that doesn't really fully develop until you're much older. That's why the neuroscience has such an important role to play in the formulation of a sensitive and responsive juvenile justice system.
Thank you so much, Mihira and Sahana, both of you. I mean, I also agree with the criminal justice system when they say that bail should be a matter of rule, especially for people who are up till 21 years of age. And as Sahana also mentioned, death sentences are often commuted if they are, you know, the crime is committed within the period of 18 to 21 as well. So clearly, neuroscience does have a huge role to play here and to ensure a reasonable system is in place. So what do you think the other jurisdictions have in this regard? Do you think India is the torchbearer, or do you think we have been swayed by public emotion, keeping Nirbhaya, obviously, the incident of Nirbhaya at the backdrop?
I mean, well, unsurprisingly, the United States, you know, is somewhere at the bottom of the list when it comes to juvenile protections, in company with countries like Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, Nigeria, Iran, not countries, Yemen. In fact, the United States still 2005, I think, still had a policy of permitting death penalty for juveniles, and has actually carried them out. It was only as recently as 2005 or 2006 that that was, you know, completely reversed. But trying juveniles as adults does exist as a policy in many states of the United States, and does not, in fact, involve many of the safeguards that we do have in our Juvenile Justice Act in terms of psychosocial care, rehabilitation, etc. Because when they are talking about trying as an adult, they mean literally as an adult, you know, not as a child being tried as an adult. I think England also allows for this. The EU has left it to member states to decide, really. So some countries do allow for it in some form. They have different age rules. But most countries don't really, a lot of countries at least don't really permit it. India is not a torchbearer either way. I would say India is fairly middling on this front. There are some countries within the European Union that don't allow it at all, but there are a fair few who do.
Yeah, I mean, I think if there are viewers here who are interested in seeing how waiver processes happen in the US, there are quite a few videos that are available on YouTube. There was one that I saw that came out just three, four days ago. And this was a hearing in which a child who was admittedly 12 years of age at the time of the manslaughter offense that he was alleged of committing, was sent to the adult system. He was 12 years old. And then he was sentenced to, I think, 25 years in jail or some such obnoxious number. And then they had to sort of fight that out and say, you know, it was not a situation which warranted it. But interestingly, like Mihira was saying, the United States is so really at the pits about this, that the argument really was on the procedural unfairness, not so much about the fact that the child was just 12 years of age. It really was not, I mean, it wouldn't have mattered if the child was maybe even 10 years of age. You know, it was just the fact that his lawyer at that particular period of time during that waiver hearing was not given adequate time to prepare. And that became the ground for sort of reversing that decision. Similarly, an interesting decision that or process that happened in the UK that I came across was the fact that certain cases are triable in adult courts, even there, like say manslaughter again. But they did not have any particular process or procedure for it. So there were two children who went up all the way to the ECHR for this, and the court then said you need to have certain practice directives. So, you know, there are practice directives and there are these procedural safeguards. That's what most jurisdictions seem to be doing, just sort of improving procedural safeguards as opposed to taking a policy decision and saying that if a child has committed a crime, irrespective of the crime, whether they were 16, 17, or 18. 18 is that benchmark, and only then can they be tried as adults.
In fact, I just while I was reading up some stuff in preparation for today, I came across a fact that I was not actually aware of till now, which was that till the 1800s, late 1800s, in most countries that did have a developed criminal justice system, the age for being tried as an adult was seven. Seven. Yeah. It was believed that by then you're old enough to understand things.
I think I remember reading this in contract law as well. For some, like, there was some age of seven which was said that, you know, now you have a sort of understanding, or there was some contract law case that I remember reading about. But as Sahana mentioned, there's another, I don't know if you guys have heard of it, but a Netflix series on the New York Park, the whatever, Central Park Five. Yeah. And it's heartbreaking to say the, you know, there were 12-year-olds to 16-year-olds who were sentenced to 30 years in prison, and they served the sentence out, and it turned out that they didn't even do it, and the person who was responsible for it was the person who, you know, admitted to the crime much later on during their sentence. And they were in fact sentenced not to the, you know, not to a juvenile care home, but they were sentenced to the normal prisons at the age of 14 or 15, which was, I think, it just like breaks your heart. Coming on to the next question, which Sahana mentioned, you know, that we have some sort of safeguards that are in place in different jurisdictions, in different sort of areas. How well are these safeguards actually implemented in India? Like Mihira also mentioned, we are somewhere in the middle. We have a law. We have some sort of safeguards. And Sahana, I remember you touching upon them earlier on when we started speaking about it. So do you want to go a little bit in detail about how they're implemented, whether they're implemented or not, whether they actually do get legal representation? As you mentioned, it's abysmal either which way. And also one more point that I wanted to make was, you said that the children were very impressionable, and they are, they usually are. But they are also, you know, there's a safeguard which says that they have to be given witness statements. How will they understand the witness statements? How will they understand the evidence? I mean, I, as a lawyer, will probably not be able to understand. I don't understand how a child will be, you know, asked to understand all of this. So Sahana or Mihira, either which way.
With the Section 15 processes and procedures, I said those were the safeguards. And like I was saying, they're often practiced in the breach rather than in practice. But with respect to what you talk, when you say, will a child really understand? Very interesting, actually. In the Juvenile Justice Act, there are certain principles that are laid out in Section 3, which I think is very unique to the Juvenile Justice Act. These are like the guiding principles to reading the statute. So it includes things like best interest of the child to, custody being the measure of last resort, and a whole bunch of other things. One of the principles is, again, actually the fact that a juvenile must be invested in the process and must be an integral part of the process. And I realize the importance of that during the course of the cases that I do, simply because the idea is not that the child, him and her or herself, will make some of the witness statement by themselves and then be able to defend themselves. That's not the point. The point is, and again, coming from the statute, the point is that the child should have a lawyer, and the child should also have a parent or a guardian along with them. And in consultation with them, the child is then able to instruct them, the adults, to then address the court. Because nobody is really at that place of incident. Right? We don't really understand the circumstances. And there is no need to take away that agency from the child. And often that is the problem. The agency is taken away in such a manner as if the court can somehow be this. I mean, it always acts as a parent's betrayal, right? It sort of assumes that it has the best interest of the child in mind, when many cases it doesn't, whether willingly or otherwise. It doesn't, because a child has certain circumstances that he or she goes through, which may not be possible for the child to share. So one example is, in fact, a case that went up to the Rajasthan High Court. This is Durga versus the state of Rajasthan, in which there was this minor girl who went through a marriage at a very early age, so this child marriage, and then she's accused of having killed her husband. Now, the fact that it was a 302 case was sufficient to having pushed her. And again, the procedures were not really met, but she was tried as an adult, she was convicted, and all of that happened. And at some point, she started getting representation. She hadn't had representation for the longest period of time. At the time that she started getting representation, that was a time when the court was sort of made aware of the circumstances in which she had to do it. And it turned out to be an act of self-defense, because her husband was somebody who was raping her, who was torturing her, and it was a very difficult marriage, and she was a child, and she did not know any better. And like Mihira was saying, this is a benefit of doubt we give to adults, right, in the normal course of justice, because we understand what happens when you're cornered. What happens when you're a child and you're cornered? Your behavior and your response is going to be just as much as of an adult, right? So to have that agency to say, this is what happened to me, and this is why I did what I did, must really rest with the child. So these procedural safeguards, I think, sort of supplement and understand this idea that the child should also be able to say, this is what happened. And see, we can understand perhaps the social circumstances also, maybe because of the probation officer report. But do we really understand the consequence that has on the child? So for instance, in the case that I'm doing, the physical report states that after the alleged incident, the CCL had abrasions on his hand. The mental health report says that he's completely fit. Goes to the probation officer. Probation officer turns out to be great. Asks him, what are these marks on your hand? And he says, I tried to cut myself because I felt so guilty. Right now, these are things, if you're not asking the child about this, the child doesn't know that he has to volunteer this information and say, I'm suicidal or I feel so terrible about this. But this is the kind of information that will only come if everybody in the system who's supposed to be part of the system speaks to the child. And that, I think, is something that is often lacking. And this is especially so when it comes to the children's court, right? Because, like I was saying, it's a sessions court. There is no way to distinguish between a CCL and an adult most often, right? Because sometimes someone who's 17 years old may look like he's 21 years old. Listen, they're not treated differently. It's not an in-camera trial. Again, another safeguard that is supposed to happen is that the children's court must, in and of itself, also make an independent assessment if the child has to be tried as an adult. But again, they end up going by the preliminary assessment of the JG board. So each of these steps, which is meant to sort of caution us that only in exceptional circumstances must you treat a child differently, ends up being something that's just like, you know, a one stage, one step to just cross on and move on. And it also has implications on, sorry, just one last point. It also has implications on bail. Because the moment you're being treated as an adult, somehow, although Section 12 of the Juvenile Justice Act is supposed to be make bail a mandatory requirement, unless it is in the best interest of the child to keep the child in custody, you end up being treated as an adult. Courts end up saying, no, you don't, you're not eligible for bail. You know, so the implications and procedural violations are just far too many.
I just want to add one thing here, you know, and that's kind of more on the desirability of, you know, coming up with a procedure like this or creating a new category of offences like this, because I don't want it to sound like, you know, the law is fine, it's justified, it's a good law, it just lacks in implementation. That's a, it's, I don't think it's a good law, because as I said, it doesn't even correspond with, you know, medical science on this front. But I think it's also important for lawmakers to understand how that law will be implemented, whether it will be implemented in its letter and spirit, or whether it will be observed, you know, in the breach more often than not, because that's not something that is divorced from lawmaking. You know, the lawmakers should also look at what is the likelihood of this being implemented in a certain way. And if that likelihood is low, then, you know, the pros and cons and the balance of, you know, whether or not you should have such a law really changes. And that needs to be taken into account. So I don't want to give the impression that, you know, the law is fine, but, you know, it's the implementation is really bad. Because if the implementation is really bad and it was predictably going to be really bad, then the law should never have been passed in the first place, and the lawmakers should have been aware of this. You know, there needs to be that kind of, you know, local, hyper-local awareness, those kind of surveys, that kind of research being undertaken before a law like this is passed that has such grave ramifications for people, young people.
And in fact, when the bill was introduced, when these amendments were introduced in the parliament, they were sent before the standing committee. And the standing committee report actually says these amendments are bad, not only in their implementation problems, which they already obviously foresaw, but even in terms of the policy decision that the government was making. And I mean, it really is the case, right? When there is a hard case, you end up coming up with these legal changes which don't really have the basic justification required. And the standing committee goes into looking at things like neuroscience. And, you know, it's basing its understanding and its sort of difficulty with accepting these amendments on that.
Thank you for your views on the act. So clearly the act was something that was clearly fully of public pressure. I do remember when the whole case of Nirbhaya had happened and how the political party that was in power was sort of also losing ground on the ground. So they sort of had a last ditch effort. And having worked on the other side of the policy implementation, I don't think that they look at the implementation aspect of it. And I think this law particularly was swayed by public emotion, was swayed by public opinion more than, you know, logic, sense, science, even law for that matter, or even it being a good policy. But moving on to another different aspect of the law, which, you know, hope is the hope that there should be rehabilitative measures, right? But do you think that they're actually there? Do you think that they actually work out? And I think, Sahana, it was you who mentioned that they're in the they're in the care homes till about 18 years of age, and then they move, or 21 years of age, and then after that they are, you know, transferred to the normal prison system. Do you think that is this even a good enough option or good enough law? And then secondly, if such measures are actually leading to them being rehabilitated after their release, if they are?
I mean, instinctively and intuitively, I think everybody here would agree, no, it makes zero sense, right? Again, most states don't have as many observation homes or children's homes that they need to. They're overcrowded, just as our prisons are. In one of the hearings, the judge, in fact, asked me, what is your problem? The juvenile is in an observation home. He is not in prison. And I didn't know how to explain to him. They're really no different. The resources perhaps are far fewer and in between, because strangely, what the JJ Act allows is for NGOs to also run and set up these observation homes and places of safety. So there really perhaps is no oversight in the kind of way state system would have. Not that state systems have perfect oversight mechanisms, as we all know, again. And again, every now and then we see in news reports, right? We don't even need a study to prove this. We hear of so many instances of sexual abuse and assault that takes place within the juvenile justice system. Drug addiction, substance abuse, very, very high. You're basically put amongst peers who also have similar concerns and issues and problems that they come from, and without having the resources to actually build the kind of rehabilitation mechanisms and systems that are required. But even so, having said all of this, there are some NGOs that do great work. There are some probation officers who do fantastic work. So even so, perhaps these homes have some kind of a process and some kind of an outlet. They finish their schooling, they learn the carpentry, they do something. But the moment you shift them into an adult prison system, none of these things exist. Again, the Act says that there should be a sort of care policy package that is a part of the sentence that is imposed on the child. But how do you ensure that it happens when our prisons don't have this mechanism? There's nothing specifically that is done within prisons. Again, most prison manuals require young offenders between, say, ages of 18 to 21 or even sometimes 22, 23 to be segregated from the older inmates, even within a prison, because they are vulnerable. That doesn't happen in practice already in any case, because prisons don't have space to have the separate place. There is really no way of having the sufficient number of personnel required to implement this effectively. And prisons don't have resources to give them the kind of possible avenues and outlets for rehabilitation that they require. So you're going from being in a home into a prison system without really going through the process of living life outside and understanding the things that are necessary for you to be equipped to be an adult. So, I mean, I think this is one of the most ridiculous things. We must have a different sort of system and vision for these children, right? Because if you're making use of the same prison system, there is no difference, there is no point of having the JJ Act. And I mean, in fact, Mihira and I were discussing, it's so strange, if you commit a crime at the age of 18, you're sent straight to prison. If you commit a crime below that, then you're sent into this holding place for 3 years, and then you're moved into the adult system. So there's also already such a lot of incongruence in the law as it stands.
Mihira, do you think that what changes would you recommend, especially when it comes to rehab measures for juveniles, if at all, within the present law? I don't think the law is going to go anywhere anytime soon. So if any measures that could improve the situation, I don't know. I mean, I hope it does, but let's be realist. Mihira, you're on mute. Sorry, you're on mute. Sorry.
I said you might as well ask me to, come up with a plan to achieve peace in the Middle East, something like that. I mean, look, fundamentally, I would say, one, there's definitely a problem of resources or allocation of resources. Our systems are under-resourced and understaffed. And the the resources, particularly the human resources that we do have, are usually don't receive the kind of training that they need to be receiving. You know, we go blue in the face. It sounds almost trite to say, you know, training and awareness and sensitization. But, you know, having said that, it's like these, you know, these principles in Section 3 that Sahana was talking about. I mean, these need to be, you know, that there's, I think when it comes to juvenile justice or any of these systems where we're really relying on, as I said, an under-resourced and an understaffed bureaucracy practically to rely on it or to implement it, it becomes a question of lip service being paid to these kind of principles, whereas these really need to be the mantra by which everybody who is part of this system really lives and breathes. You know, that's the kind of, it needs to be not just about awareness as much as really kind of, I don't know, imbibing it. And, you know, that focus needs to be, it cannot be something like, you know, one sort of training workshop in a year kind of thing. You know, it needs to be constant. And it needs to go hand in hand with, of course, upgrading resources and facilities, infrastructure, better allocation. But fundamentally, there needs to be more sensitivity all around and more acceptance of the idea that this is something. I think a lot of people, even sometimes people who are part of the system, don't quite accept the rationale for that system. So it's not, I think it's that culture really does need to be, you know, shifted. You're on mute.
Sorry, thank you so much for both of you for your excellent comments. I hope this does, like, this law does actually either go away, because that's what the conclusion seems to be. But since this law sort of targets heinous offences, and like you guys mentioned in the starting comments, that mostly these have to do with sexual offences or sexual offences, you know, sexual assault. So what about the grey areas in law, like consensual sex between minors and age of sexual maturity? Do you guys have anything that you would like to shed light on?
I think age is a question where we as a society, and that includes our government, we've not really come to any kind of clear answer on what we consider, because I mean, we have, you know, we saw this very recently when it came to the entire you know, marriage age debate. And, you know, then you have a different age for, you know, 18 is for, then there's a different age for men, women, different age for driving, drinking, voting. And when it comes to sexual conduct, there is essentially what the law says right now is essentially that while you are old enough to accept the consequences and appreciate the consequences of forced sexual intercourse when you are 16 years old, you're not old enough to actually enter into consensual sexual relationship at the age of 16. You know, so it's as if there's the responsibility, but not the freedom. Because under POCSO, for instance, there is no leniency that is given to consensual sexual intercourse between two minors. So that's one gray area. And that's something I think we also, as people working in the field, have to grapple with, because we also would, you know, like to see some leniency when it comes to the age of consensual sex, because we want there to be, you know, just from a anti-incarceral position. And on the other hand, you know, accept, but that same position then also means not recognizing the consequences when it comes to the juvenile justice. So that's something that we also have to grapple with, though I think there's a lot more solidity when that argument is coming from an anti-carceral position. There's also, because the POCSO is the only sexual assault law really that is gender neutral in terms of the identity of both the victim and the perpetrator. And we've not had that before in this country. And because it doesn't really allow for a situation where there can be consensual sex between two minors, you literally have a situation where if there is a case of consensual sex between two minors who are between the ages of 16 and 18, both of them can be tried as adults for raping each other.
Yeah.
It's bizarre.
Sounds ridiculous, yes.
And actually, the numbers would show this, right? There's studies after studies in different states that show that the number of POCSO cases, which are genuine, and those that are actually, at least prima facie, seem to be consensual sexual relationship between adults, teenagers, is just that much high. The proportion is just so high. And our prisons just don't have the space. Like, there are some prisons in which at least half the population is these young boys who are in prison for falling in love. It's quite ridiculous.
And, in fact, even on the recent, debates on marital rape, because of the hearing that's been going on before the Delhi High Court, so much of the public discourse has been on false rape cases, and this entire bogey that's been raised, and a really large number of them are cases, filed by parents or other, mandatory reporting kind of cases under POCSO where there was consensual sex between minors. That's really something we need to resolve.
Or maybe there's even no sex. It's just that the parents want the relationship to end. The false cases are just, how do you deal with POCSO in court and ask for bail? You can't.
I'm at the end of my points that I wanted to address, but do you guys have any final comments, anything that you would like to add?
Maybe we can take some questions.
Perfect, that sounds great. Does anybody have any questions? Shri, I'm sorry if your name's on that, but you've raised your hand. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. I'm sorry for any sound disturbance, but my question was about you were talking about the incarceration system, the prison system, right? About how if someone was tried at 18 and got convicted, they'd be directly sent to jail, like the normal adult jail. But then if it was a juvenile, like a person who was aged 17, they would be sent into the juvenile prison system and then further into the adult system. So how do you think that can be fixed? Because obviously an 18-year-old is not that much different than from a 17-year-old.
Do you want to take that, Mihira?
So yeah, two things. One, of course, on this point, there's a little bit of a contradiction because it's not as if the person is being transferred at the age of 18 to the adult system. The person is being transferred at the age of 21. So that obviously leads to a little bit of a contradiction. Though there is a rationale for that, which I think Sahana will be better placed to explain, as she was explaining it to me. But the other thing is, as you say, yes, a 17-year-old is not that different from an 18-year-old. And that's just one of the perils of having to draw a line somewhere. It could be 20 and 21. It could be 24 and 25. Wherever you choose to draw that line, there's not that much difference in somebody right before and right after.
Yeah, and just to sort of answer why I think that this conflict exists is because, like I was saying, before these amendments, the maximum period of time until when a juvenile could have been kept in one of these homes was for 3 years. So presumably 21 was fixed for that. And that's not something that's applied equivocally for adults. But what I think could be one way forward, and again, prison manuals sort of try to do this, but aren't able to really implement it, is to, even within a prison system, segregate people who are between 18 and 21 and sort of give them a very different sort of daily routine within a prison system. Because you're right, there is I mean, between 17 and 18, I don't really see a very fundamental difference, so to speak. So to perhaps take 21 as a sort of guiding light from the JJ Act and to say that that should be a policy decision we take for young adults in our justice system.
Yes, and I think it would also be in consonance with the IPC, the CRPC, where bail and commutation of sentences is, you know, hedged at 21. So Paritosh had a question. It's a little wordy, but I will read it out. According to the Youth Courts Act in Germany, a juvenile shall mean anyone who, at the time of the Act, has reached the age of 14 but not yet 18 years. A young adult shall mean anyone who, at the time of the Act, has reached the age of 18 but not of 21 years. This categorization therefore mitigates the application of criminal law up till the age of 20 years. So it's relevant for terrorism offenses where it's often seen that young adult is radicalized into committing unlawful activities. Do you think that the Indian law could be amended with such a categorization?
Sorry, do you mean categorization of age or do you mean categorization of alleged terror activity?
I think age for criminal offenses. I think that's my understanding of it.
I mean, see, I think of all the systems that I've come across so far, I think the German system seems the most sort of, I don't know, liberal in the sense that 14 is a different age. And I mean, until 14, if you've committed any crime whatsoever, you're not going to be treated in the justice system, criminal justice system, unlike in most other jurisdictions. And 18 is, again, a hard hit. You know, you're not going to be imprisoned or given the kind of sentences, and you're still going to be lenient thereafter. I don't know if that's a good thing to do here, because if we end up having these ifs and buts, like we've discussed through the course of this conversation in an Indian system, it is going to be a problem. So I think the most sensible thing would be to say 18 is when you are moved into the adult system. Anything below that, you're treated as a child in conflict with the law. I think confusion just makes things worse.
And like you said, that the line has to be drawn somewhere. So the line should ideally be drawn at 18.
Because it's already drawn for us. This law in 2000 came because we were trying to be in compliance with international law. Right. So,
Mihira, do you have any comments?
Yeah, I broadly agree with Sahana. I think judicially, we do see that the younger the offender, even, you know, above the age of 18, 19, 20, 21, we do see there is greater leniency that is shown by the judge. That's a matter of discretion. But it does exist, and it's a fairly well established. Again, of course, subject to other circumstances like public outcry and things like that. Nobody can predict the outcome of public outcry. But, by and large, that is the situation. So I do think that it wouldn't be unreasonable to say that, you know, you have one age and then leave it to the court's discretion after that to mitigate the sentence based on relative youth. And also, you know, there is so much dispute in India, more than, you know, say in the context of Germany, that was the example that was given. There's so much dispute about a person's age. You know, age is not something that is always recorded. So we'll be going into a really complicated mess, you know, the more categories you create.
Thank you so much. Sri, you had another question?
I'm so sorry if I may.
No,
it's more of a comment that I want. A lot of, we've been discussing age and incarceration and sexual assault. So in a lot of countries, there are laws like Romeo and Juliet law, where if in a consensual relationship, one of them is a major and a minor, that's acceptable within a limit. Like, what is your, like, do you have any comments on that? And do you think that would work in India if it was implemented?
Again, we're going to be playing with numbers, but I think there is some value to be had in that conversation, because if, say, the man is 21 and the girl is 17, maybe there is an argument to be made that there was a relationship of consent and respect and equality, but it's again, it's very murky waters, right? We're also a country where gender equality and inequality is a very complicated situation. At 17, she's still in school, and at 21, he's probably in college or he's working. You know, so power play between different age periods may be different. But yeah, maybe plus or minus 2-3 years, maybe. Maybe that's something. I don't know. I haven't really thought about this.
Because those laws that we have right now, they're also, they can also be like implemented in a manner where this one of them is 17 and the other one is 18, and then they're a major, and then it becomes illegal, right? I mean, it's illegal either way, but then qualifies as rape.
What we've seen in some cases, at least, is, and again, I don't know if this is good practice or just something judges end up doing because they see no other way. They end up taking these affidavits in court, in the high court, where they use their inherent power, and they say that, okay, they've now decided to reconcile, get married or whatever. Right? But I mean, how do you really gauge which of those is a genuine case, which is not? I don't know, it's a complicated process. Mihira?
I don't want to be, you know, making a hard and fast kind of pronouncement that, you know, this should not be there. But I think instinctively, I'm not in favor. I support that kind of rule when it is within a specified age difference, but between two minors. Right? Like, say, a 15-year-old and a 17-year-old. You know, that kind, I think that sort of interaction should be protected. But I think that there is a real benefit to that age, which, you know, we've sort of decided broadly as a society is 18. There is a benefit to that age being the sort of threshold. And a person who is above that age, I don't really see an overwhelming reason to, you know, to allow that legally. That is a person above the age of 18 and somebody else below the age of 18, because I think that the harms of allowing that legally are far too great. I don't really see an overwhelming reason to change that. Where I do see the benefit of a kind of Romeo and Juliet law, as I said, is between two minors, where there is, say, a specified age gap of 2 years or something like that, up to 2 years. Now, that's just how I instinctively feel about it. I mean, I don't think there is anything so wrong with keeping a specific age of statutory rape when it is committed by an adult.
Of course, that, I mean, line has to be drawn somewhere, right? I think not that I know much about it, but I think I instinctively also agree with Mihira when she says this.
Reason is also, I think that's something that is fairly easy to communicate.
Yeah, probably, yes.
You know, easy. I mean, relatively, it's not something that can that necessarily leads to a lot of confusion. It's a clear, bright line. And I don't think that there's necessarily any urgency that really requires that to be changed.
I understand this, and I broadly also agree with Mihira, but I'm just wondering, what if it's 17 and 19? You know, of course, we do end up having to draw lines. So I think...
Not to be offensive about this, but I guess I would just say wait a year. I mean, I don't know what other answer I could say. I realize that really puts me on firmly the other side of the age divide to suggest something like that. But I really don't know... what else is a reasonable response? Seems reasonable to me.
Yeah. No, but I guess the idea is to also make the POCSO Act a little more, I'd say, open to being wrestled with, as opposed to how it is at the moment. It's so strongly worded, so you know, like etched in stone, which is necessary. Of course, we all understand that there is a necessity to respond to what is a grave problem. But like we started in the beginning, right, the response to a criminal situation or a situation of societal concern is not always harsher punishment. So perhaps having a little bit of leeway, perhaps at the time of sentencing, perhaps maybe waiting until the girl reaches the age of majority, where she is the alleged victim or the person who survived this, to go on and to then make a decision. I don't know, you know, maybe perhaps it has to be more evolved in understanding. What do you think, Sri, since you asked this question, you have?
I think Sri.
Sri, okay.
Hi, yeah. Okay, so my opinion was the first time I'd heard of the Romeo and Juliet law was during a Law and Order episode, and I realized that it was very, like, it actually concerned, like, at least us, like, my generation, the way we grew up. We had a really positive, most of us at least, had a really positive attitude about sex and everything. And a lot of us engaged in relationships during high school, right, where one of them would be in grade 10 and the other one would be in 12, and the age difference is of 2 years. And the other one would graduate and go on to college, and they're a major now. But then the relationship doesn't end there. It still continues. And obviously, they're teased around and etc., but the fact that it's illegal and that it's not, it doesn't come under POCSO anymore. It's actual rape, it's statutory rape. I don't think that's fair. Because it can go
that's a fair point.
Maybe to look at it in another way and to say maybe the age of consent has to be reduced is one thing, one other way of looking at it, right? So to say 16.
I mean, what we've been arguing, I mean, one of the suggestions that has been constantly put forward is that, you know, the age of a consent be lowered to 16 only with respect to, say, a partner who is up to 2 years older, not more than that. But somewhere a line will have to be drawn and somebody is going to fall out of that protection. So, you know, it could be somebody, you know, whose partner is 3 years older. And why should that suddenly? But that's certainly one possibility that you have, say, lower the age of consent to 16 for specific kinds of relationships or specific nature of whatever intercourse, which is how the law would define it, where, you know, say the age difference is. But I would strongly argue for a cap on that age difference.
Since, I mean, I think it just got very interesting towards the end. We should have taken this much earlier on. But since there are no more questions, thank you once again, Mihira and Sahana, for joining. And thank you to Article 14 as well for this wonderful and truthful discussion. If people want to get in touch with you, I hope they can. Do you mind sharing your email IDs? Because I think this was an amazing discussion.
Yeah, sure.
Do you have any final comments or can I end the session now?